Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents America Ascendant, The Rise of American Exceptionalism by Dennis M. Spragg, narrated by Tom Perkins. Fellow citizens, we cannot escape history. We of this Congress and this administration will be remembered in spite of ourselves. No personal significance or insignificance can spare one or another of us. The fiery trial through which we pass will light us down, in honor or dishonor, to the latest generation. We say we are for the Union. The world will not forget that we say this. We know how to save the Union. The world knows we do know how to save it. We, even we here, hold the power and bear the responsibility. In giving freedom to the slave, we assure freedom to the free, honorable alike in what we give and what we preserve. We shall nobly save or meanly lose the last best hope of earth. Other means may succeed. This could not fail. The way is plain, peaceful, generous, just. A way which, if followed, the world will forever applaud, and God must forever bless. President Abraham Lincoln, December 1, 1862. Prologue. The United States of America is an exceptional nation that uniquely transcends region, race, and religion. Dictionaries define the word exceptional as A. forming an exception, rare, B. better than average, superior, and C. deviating from the norm, such as having above average intelligence. Historians have used variations of all three definitions to explain how 13 British North American colonies became an independent nation that developed into a global superpower. Attempts to define American exceptionalism differ by era, and national leaders have engaged in a robust debate over the meaning of America for most of the nation's history. 19th century and early 20th century political discourse was a contest between expansionism versus morality. The main themes were manifest destiny and the question of slavery. The competing ideals were well defined and widely argued. For example, Hamilton Federalism versus Jeffersonian Republicanism, the abolitionist North versus the slave South, and Wilsonian Progressivism versus Lodge Pragmatism. It took the greatest challenge in American history and skilled leadership to cause an intersection of the competing impulses to unify the nation and define American exceptionalism. Franklin Delano Roosevelt, aided by exceptional bipartisan statesmen and soldiers, changed the dynamic of competing American visions by replacing expansionism as a national imperative and replacing it with interventionism, which he defined in the Atlantic Charter as a moral responsibility. Interventionism became victory and then internationalism with the founding of the United Nations. America conceived and led far-reaching global relief, economic aid, and security arrangements that have lasted into the 21st century. Two exceptional generations of Americans directed and fought World War II. An extraordinary bipartisan government alliance with industrial and media leaders, all of whom were born in the late 19th century, had the imagination and reason to organize and communicate on an unprecedented scale. Roosevelt's Office of War Information, Hollywood, and the broadcasting industry capably defined American exceptionalism at home and abroad. Millions of exceptional Americans born in the 20th century did not hesitate to do what was necessary to save the world. They unselfishly proved American exceptionalism on the battlefield, upholding and advancing American values. The alliance between government and media, including the Office of War Information, Hollywood, and broadcasters, defined and communicated the convergence of national interest with moral imperative. As young Americans proved exceptionalism on battlefields in every corner of the earth, they and their fellow Americans, motivated by the ideas and ideals of their forebears and leaders communicated to them by the alliance, went on to build an enlightened post-war world. The exceptional generations did not simply achieve victory in a global war of survival, but they did so to create a better world without the motivation of territorial conquest. What they achieved after the war, and how the history of America empowered them to be exceptional, is as important as their service. They need not be America's most exceptional generations in the decades and centuries to follow. There will certainly be others who will carry the torch. The 21st century descendants of the exceptional generations have diverse and inaccurate ideas about what American exceptionalism is. Polarized political discourse has upset the equilibrium won by the wartime generations. The Vietnam War, Watergate, and the personal imperfections of self-absorbed and unorthodox politicians have clouded the memory and awareness of Americans about where they came from, why they are exceptional, what exceptionalism really is, and how they can apply exceptionalism to continue building a better nation and world. This includes the constructive role of the media and its relationship to sound governance. The modern American media, political establishment, and special interest groups have divided themselves among red and blue states, race, gender, and lifestyle. Amazing technologies are isolating Americans rather than bringing them together. As media have fragmented among confusing options and voices, the dependable world of Walter Cronkite has devolved into a Tower of Babel. News has become commentary as journalism has descended into partisan argument. As universities have become racially diverse but intellectually segregated as leftist bastions, false traditionalist prophets have appeared in response, preaching long discredited doctrines of isolation and intolerance. Citizens caught in the middle yearn for a renaissance of civility and mourn the absence of civics in revisionist classrooms. Generations that have come of age during and after the pivotal Vietnam War era, devoid of civics and history, might consider the Nicomachean ethics espoused by Aristotle, that earlier generations of conscientious Americans well understood. In medio stat virtus, virtue stands in the middle, or good practice lies in the middle path. What 21st century Americans and the exceptional generations have in common with their forebears is liberty, equal justice, and a respect for human dignity. With the momentous achievements of victory and global leadership came the blessings of great wealth and power, but also an important duty. American leaders have not always appreciated these blessings or acted as responsible stewards of their trust. Although the nation has always continued along a progressive and ascending trajectory, mistakes and missed opportunities have bred cynicism among the intellectual class, political elite, and media that polarizes 21st century American discourse. America's founders had an astonishingly different vision for their nation and humanity than the kingdoms of their time and the technologically advanced nation-state, corporate, and academic dictatorships of today. Their experiment in liberal mercantile democracy has evolved, but their Constitution and Bill of Rights remain as milestones in the march of human progress, liberty, and rational thinking from the first tribes to the classical Greek and Roman republics, the English Magna Carta, and the European Renaissance. America is still an enlightened concept as well as an exceptional nation. With struggle and sacrifice, mid-20th century America found a mature equilibrium that allowed it to create a new world order and cleanse its sins. America liberated more people from tyranny and poverty than any nation in history, rejected territorial conquest, was magnanimous and generous, fought a war of national and cultural survival against fascism with no quarter asked or given, but also had the wisdom to fight a Cold War against communism with restraint and invested in the planet by rebuilding it while supporting self-determination. Many pundits and politicians claim American exceptionalism is a dangerous myth and that there has never been anything exceptional about America. Cynics seek to expunge history with virtuous revisionist manifestos erasing evidence and dismantling monuments. The truth of America is both inspiring and intermittently problematic, but it stands on its own historic merit. Americans cannot deny, polish, or forget their heritage if the United States is to continue moving forward toward its inexorable purpose. American exceptionalism is not the manifest destiny of the 19th century, the ambitious aftermath of the Spanish-American War, or Woodrow Wilson's zealotry. America never was and is not an imperialist power. Americans have long rejected imperial privilege and have either at their best embraced global leadership and responsibility or at their worst retreated into isolation and protectionism. The United States once came to a rendezvous with destiny and forever changed the course of human history. This is the story of how an ascendant America came to define itself and be an exceptional nation. A knowledge of history is important to the defense of our cause. This enables us to rebut falsehoods and place truths in proper perspective. Major General Vernon A. Walters. Part 1. Manifest Destiny. This is the time of all others when democracy should prove its purity and its spiritual power to prevail. It is surely the manifest destiny of the United States to lead in the attempt to make this spirit prevail. President Thomas Woodrow Wilson, December 7, 1920. 1. From Sea to Shining Sea. The Blessings of Freedom. On July 4, 1776, at Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, the 56 delegates to the Continental Congress, standing for 13 colonies, pledged their lives and fortunes by signing a Declaration of Independence from Great Britain. This was an exceptional decision, and the colonial representatives were taking a grave risk. The delegates were committing high treason and would pay with their heads if their cause faltered. And as it happened, some did lose their lives and many more lost their fortunes. Their unprecedented declaration had come over a year after the outbreak of hostilities in the province of Massachusetts Bay on April 19, 1775. On the extraordinary morning of October 19, 1781, Brigadier General Charles O'Hara surrendered besieged British forces at Yorktown, Virginia, to General George Washington, commander of the Continental Army, General Comte de Rochambeau, and Admiral Comte de Barras of France. O'Hara represented British commanding general Lord George Cornwallis, who, pleading illness, refused to attend the ceremony. Perhaps confusing the elegant Rochambeau for Washington, O'Hara awkwardly offered his sword to the French commander, who graciously declined in deference to the American commander. As he sat astride Nelson, his favorite mount, Washington directed his deputy, Major General Benjamin Lincoln, to accept O'Hara's sword. O'Hara had marched the British forces, including many German mercenaries, out of Yorktown between two lines of Allied troops, the French on one side and the Americans on the other. The French and American lines stretched for more than a mile. The repercussions and recriminations in London were immediate. Bogged down in expensive struggles in other realms, an exhausted Parliament passed a resolution in March 1782 to end the costly war with the American colonies. The Treaty of Paris formally ended the American Revolutionary War in September 1783. The Constitution of the United States was ratified June 21, 1788. There are 27 amendments to the Constitution, and the first 10 amendments are known collectively as the Bill of Rights. The Constitution replaced the Articles of Confederation and Perpetual Union that the newly independent 13 states ratified in early 1781. The Articles of Confederation incapacitated the new nation by limiting the role of a central government. The Articles did not bring unity, effectively fund a national government, or support national defense. Deliberations toward a new constitution convened May 25, 1787, in Philadelphia. Following lengthy and raucous debate for over a year among disparate state delegations and then ratification by 11 of the 13 states, The Continental Congress voted on September 13, 1788, to implement the Constitution. A new federal government met on March 4, 1789, and George Washington became president on April 30th. Two holdouts, North Carolina and Rhode Island, later ratified the Constitution. The frail Benjamin Franklin was too weak to stand and asked James Wilson to read his closing comments at the convention to the delegates, in which he said, in part, "I confess that there are several parts of this Constitution which I do not at present approve, but I am not sure I shall never approve them, for having lived long I have experienced many instances of being obliged by better information or fuller consideration to change opinions even on important subjects which I once thought right but found to be otherwise. It is, therefore, that the older I grow, the more apt I am to doubt my own judgment and to pay more respect to the judgment of others. Sir, I agree to this Constitution, with all its faults, if they are such, because I think a general government necessary for us, and there is no form of government but what may be a blessing to the people if well administered, and believe farther that this is likely to be well administered for a course of years, and can only end in despotism, as other forms have done before it, when the people shall become so corrupted as to need despotic government, being incapable of any other. I doubt, too, whether any other convention we can obtain may be able to make a better constitution. It therefore astonishes me, sir, to find this system approaching so near to perfection as it does, and I think it will astonish our enemies, who are waiting with confidence to hear that our councils are confounded like those of the builders of Babel, and that our states are on the point of separation, only to meet hereafter for the purpose of cutting one another's throats. Thus, I consent, sir, to this Constitution because I expect no better, and because I am not sure that it is not the best." Franklin and his colleagues thus embarked upon the creation of a truly revolutionary experiment in human freedom and expression, grounded upon English common law, property rights, individual freedoms, capitalism, and Judeo-Christian values. The Provident Constitution embodied this unprecedented combination of core principle. The fragile new nation was unique in human history and destined to be exceptional. His countrymen and the national media revered and glorified General George Washington at the time of his inauguration. By the end of his first term, writers were attacking Washington's domestic and foreign policies. During his second term, media attacks became personal and questioned the president's integrity, Republican principles, and even his military reputation. Revolutionary unity had disappeared. A new type of rough-and-tumble American political and media dynamic had appeared. The nature of this new atmosphere would evolve, but continue throughout the history of the United States, where the First Amendment to the 1789 Constitution enshrined freedom of speech. The media included no more than 50 newspapers in 1776. By 1800, there were 250, because new regulations made it less expensive to circulate newspapers through the postal system. Aggressive editors criticized the monarchical style and aristocratic behavior of the Washington administration. Reluctant to attack Washington directly, editors aimed considerable criticism at his lieutenants, particularly Treasury Secretary Alexander Hamilton. In a letter to New York Representative James Madison, Secretary of State Thomas Jefferson wrote, "The president, though an honest man himself, may be circumvented by snares and artifices, and is in fact surrounded by men who wish to clothe the executive with more than constitutional power." Allied with Jefferson against the Federalist economic policy of Hamilton, Madison organized the opposition Democratic-Republican Party, which he centered around Jefferson. Opposition newspapers gave the new party an opportunity to frame the debate in terms of republicanism versus aristocracy. In April 1793, Washington proclaimed that the United States would remain neutral in a quarrel between revolutionary France and Great Britain. the media and the new political opposition were pro-French, and they denounced Washington's decision. The president ratified a document formally titled Treaty of Amity, Commerce, and Navigation Between His Britannic Majesty and the United States of America in August 1795. The document was better known as the Jay Treaty because Special Envoy John Jay, Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, negotiated it. Washington wanted to avoid war over justified claims that the British government was refusing to open its ports to American shipping. Jay signed the document on November 19, 1794. It took 4 months to reach the president on March 7, 1795, when Congress had adjourned. The media were stymied by secrecy, and rampant newspaper speculation stirred public agitation. The Senate met in special session on June 8, 1795, to consider the treaty. Members objected particularly to Article 12, which limited commercial access to the British West Indies to ships of 70 tons or less. The Senate approved the treaty subject to the suspension of Article 12. Washington concluded that the partial approval implied final consent. Newspapers were outraged, and riots ensued with public bonfires of the Union Jack. An appalled Washington urged his advisors to fight back against the poison of political and media opponents. After Washington ratified the Jay Treaty unconditionally, protests continued. The House of Representatives demanded the president send documents related to the treaty. In an early example of what today is known as executive privilege, Washington refused, insisting that the House had no constitutional authority to determine treaties. In May 1796, the president expressed the hope that his action would offer the United States peace and the time to become a prosperous nation. Born out of wedlock on the island of Nevis in the West Indies, Alexander Hamilton served as a decorated combat officer and Washington's military aide-de-camp during the Revolution. He founded the new nation's financial system as its first Treasury Secretary and was a key advocate for the Constitution of the United States. Hamilton, John Jay, and James Madison published 85 articles, essays using the pseudonym Publius, which are now known as the Federalist Papers. Hamilton's commentaries were provocative, rational, and influential. Hamilton believed that it was the manifest destiny of the original colonies to become a continental nation by expanding to the Pacific Ocean. He also predicted that the United States would become the dominant hemispheric power. Arguing for a strong central government, Hamilton followed British financial practices advocating capitalism, common interests, and a strong American navy. He helped to create an American sense of identity by developing key institutions during the vital first presidency of national hero George Washington. Hamilton believed that the United States could become a great empire. He supported the annexation of all territories east of the Mississippi, including Florida. In Federalist 11, Hamilton argued that geography, abundant natural resources, and the national interest favored the creation of one great American system superior to the control of all transatlantic force or influence, and able to dictate the terms of the connection between the old and the new world. During the Washington administration, the political class and media of the new nation divided between the competing visions of the Democratic Republicans and the Federalists. The Democratic Republicans, led by Jefferson, represented Southern agrarian and slave ownership interests and favored close relations with France. The Federalists, led by Hamilton and including Washington's vice president and presidential successor John Adams, represented Northern commercial interests and favored close relations with Britain. The parties agreed the nation should expand and that the federal government needed the necessary power to control diplomacy and the military. Jefferson prevailed in the important election of 1800, which led to the disappearance of Hamilton's Federalist Party. Jefferson appointed James Madison as his Secretary of State. The February 6, 1778 Treaty of Alliance between the United States and France promised mutual military support to endure in perpetuity. This open-ended marriage bothered Hamilton and the Federalists. On January 21, 1793, the citizens of the Revolutionary French Republic executed King Louis XVI. Hamilton wanted to nullify the treaty since it was with the deposed monarchy. Washington sided with Secretary of State Jefferson and kept the treaty in effect. On April 22, Washington proclaimed American neutrality when the new French Republic declared war on Britain. Jefferson resigned as Secretary of State on December 31. The formal Neutrality Act followed in 1794, which prompted a bitter media and pamphlet war between Hamilton, writing as Pacificus, and Madison, replying as Helvidius. The United States delayed payment of Revolutionary War debt to France. The French Republic retaliated by seizing American merchant vessels in the West Indies. In reply, Congress canceled the Treaty of 1778 and authorized attacks on French vessels on July 7, 1798. An undeclared war followed. With tacit support from the British and showing surprising professional fighting ability, the new American Navy destroyed French West Indies trade. Between 1801 and 1805, the fledgling Navy and the Marine Corps would again show their ability to the shores of Tripoli in the first of two wars with Barbary pirates in Africa. President Adams had to deal with pro-French Democratic Republicans and anti-French members of his own party. He sought a diplomatic solution with France, which enraged Federalists. France ceded Louisiana to Spain in the 1763 Treaty of Paris, which combined the vast Louisiana landmass with Spanish Florida. The deal blocked any potential expansion of the United States at the Mississippi River. At the same time, Scots-Irish Americans were pouring across the Appalachian Mountains into the Ohio and Tennessee River valleys, and the economic development of lands west of the Appalachians needed access to the Mississippi River. Upon the discovery of French agents conducting military surveys to determine how best to defend Louisiana, the Federalist-dominated Congress passed and President John Adams signed the Alien and Sedition Acts in 1798. The acts were four individual bills that set off a political and media firestorm and affected the presidential election of 1800. Democratic Republican and media critics argued the acts suppressed opponents of the Adams administration. Public opinion was raw following the Whiskey Rebellion, when Democratic Republican officials in some states refused to enforce the 1791 whiskey tax. The French Revolution inspired other Democratic Republican politicians and media to call for secession. In acting to keep order, Adams and the Federalists set themselves up for electoral defeat. Following his victory over Adams in the 1800 election, Thomas Jefferson repealed three of the four acts. The Alien Enemies Act is still in effect as Chapter 3, Sections 21 through 24 of Title 50 of the United States Code. Meanwhile, Napoleon Bonaparte orchestrated the coup of 18 Brumaire on November 9, 1799, and became First Consul of the French Republic. Adams authorized a commission to negotiate with France a formal end of the 1778 Treaty of Alliance, confirmation of American neutrality, an agreement for shipping loss compensation, and to end the undeclared naval war. One of the commissioners was Virginian John Marshall, who became Chief Justice of the Supreme Court in 1801. What Adams did not know was that Napoleon wanted to reestablish a North American empire. The Adams Commission did not arrive in Paris until March 1800. By then, France was negotiating the transfer of Louisiana from Spain. On September 30, 1800, the United States and France signed the Convention of 1800, or Treaty of Montfontaine, ending the undeclared naval war and the 1778 Treaty of Alliance. Shipping loss compensation remained unresolved. Spain transferred Louisiana to France in the 1801 Treaty of Aranjuez. Napoleon sent troops to the West Indies to restore the production of sugar and to use New Orleans as a strategic base. Then many of the French troops died of yellow fever, a slave rebellion seized control of Haiti, and renewed hostilities with Great Britain were likely. Adroitly understanding the French position, Jefferson dispatched James Madison to join Ambassador Robert Livingstone in Paris to buy Louisiana. Negotiations moved swiftly. The United States agreed to pay $11.5 million and assume the shipping loss claims of American citizens against France of $3.75 million. In exchange, the United States bought the vast Louisiana domain of 830,000 square miles, stretching from the Gulf of Mexico to Canada and from the Mississippi River to the Rocky Mountains. Jefferson had pulled off the biggest land deal in history, paying exactly 4 cents per acre. On December 20, 1803, a French honor guard lowered the French tricolor in the Place d'Armes, and an American honor guard raised the American flag. As sophisticated French and Spanish residents wept in disbelief, William Claiborne and General James Wilkinson, the new territorial commissioners, assured all residents that the United States would respect their property, rights, and Catholic religion. Celebratory salvos boomed from dozens of cannons as proud Americans shouted huzzah. Hamilton supported Jefferson's astute and epic purchase of Louisiana, which fit perfectly with Hamilton's vision of continental expansion. Rich in natural resources, with endless forests and grazing lands, the vast Louisiana realm made America wealthy. The president announced, "The fertility of the country, its climate and extent, promise in due season important aids to our treasury, an ample provision for our posterity, and a widespread field for the blessings of freedom." Jefferson commissioned Captain Meriwether Lewis, Lieutenant William Clark, and their Corps of Discovery expedition to explore the lands northwest from St. Louis, along the muddy Missouri River, among the many unfamiliar indigenous nations, and to discover a practical route from the mysterious Rocky Mountains to the Pacific Ocean. This exceptional undertaking into the vast unknown, guided by the Lenni Shoshone woman Sacajawea from North Dakota to the Pacific Ocean, also sought trade with the tribes and scientific study. The trek was no less daunting in its time than men traveling to the moon. Aaron Burr of New York served as vice president during Jefferson's first term, but Jefferson never trusted him. Burr had been Jefferson's presidential opponent, and their uneasy relationship led in part to a change in the vice presidential election process. When Burr realized that Jefferson would decline to run with him in the 1804 election, he ran and lost the election for governor of New York. Alexander Hamilton opposed Burr, who he believed was involved in a secession movement. A letter in which Hamilton described Burr as a dangerous man came to Burr's attention. After several exchanges of letters, Burr demanded that Hamilton either recant or deny the accusations, which Hamilton did not. Burr then challenged Hamilton to a duel. The foes met at Weehawken, New Jersey, at 7 a.m. on July 11, 1804, and Burr fatally wounded Hamilton. For generations, slaves were an integral element of trade between black African nations, slave traders, the New World, and Europe. About 6% of the 12 million Africans forced to the Western Hemisphere came to British North America. Following independence, northern states gradually abolished slavery, and the Progressive Northwest Ordinance outlawed it. The United States and Britain banned the importation of slaves in 1808, and Britain outlawed slavery throughout the empire in 1833. Although crop and climate conditions in the upper southern states made slavery impractical, owners and traders cruelly separated and transplanted slave families to the Deep South, where a lucrative cotton economy made slavery profitable. The United States fought a second war with Great Britain between June 1812 and February 1815. The Treaty of Ghent, signed December 24, 1814, ended the conflict with a status quo antebellum, a draw. News of the peace did not arrive before British forces invaded Louisiana in January 1815. General Andrew Jackson and his odd army of regulars, militia, civilians, slaves, indigenous peoples, and Jean Lafitte's pirates dramatically defeated the finest army in the world at the Battle of New Orleans. After the war, the United States adopted a policy of political isolation from Europe and economic accommodation with Britain and British North America, Canada. In his December 2, 1823 State of the Union Address, President James Monroe outlined a hemispheric foreign policy that came to be known as the Monroe Doctrine. Mainly written by Secretary of State John Quincy Adams, the policy opposed European colonialism in the Western Hemisphere, although the United States recognized existing European colonies. In exchange, the United States pledged not to interfere with the internal affairs of European nations. Simón Bolívar and other Latin American nationalists welcomed Monroe's pledge, although they did not view the doctrine as a hemispheric alliance. The United States, founded upon English common law and British tradition, was developing along different lines than its southern hemispheric neighbors. At the turn of the 19th century, the freeborn population of the infant United States was primarily of Northern European heritage, as contrasted with the diversity of minority European, slave, and majority indigenous and assimilated mixed-race populations of the Americas. The Northwest Territory, including Ohio, Michigan, Indiana, Illinois, and Wisconsin, was rich in timber, furs, minerals, and fertile land. The Appalachian Mountains blocked transportation to the interior. It took 4 weeks to travel from New York to Detroit, and the rivers of the interior flowed west into the Mississippi Basin and south to New Orleans. Westward expansion to the Great Lakes had to pass through the Iroquois, Haudenosaunee, Confederacy of Cayuga, Mohawk, Oneida, Onondaga, Seneca, and Tuscarora nations. The Confederacy had hitherto blocked the French and contained the British. During the American Revolution, the nations divided their loyalties, and the colonials defeated the pro-British members. The Six Nations signed the Treaty of Canandaigua with President George Washington on November 11, 1794, which has continued to affirm perpetual Haudenosaunee land rights to the present day. The idea of a Mohawk Valley Canal appeared during the 1780s. Beginning in 1807, flour merchant Jesse Hawley began authoring essays describing a Mohawk Valley Canal system, and his ideas caught the attention of New York City Mayor DeWitt Clinton. When Clinton became governor of New York, he launched a canal project, and construction began in 1817. Critics called the project Clinton's Folly and Clinton's Ditch. Free labor, including many Irish immigrants, built a water highway between the Hudson River and Lake Erie that Clinton opened on October 28, 1825. There is an elevation difference of 565 feet between the eastern and western terminuses, so the Erie Canal had 34 numbered locks to lift and lower boats and barges. The important waterway was an unprecedented engineering feat that revolutionized the shipment of goods from the Great Lakes to the Atlantic Ocean. It is the best early example of American ingenuity. As the result of the bitter and tumultuous election of 1828, Populist General Andrew Jackson of Tennessee became President of the United States. The intensely charged election was even more controversial because of personal attacks against Jackson's wife, Rachel, by supporters of incumbent President John Quincy Adams. The stress led to her death 3 weeks after her husband's victory. Jackson never forgave the Adams supporters, saying, "May God forgive her murders, I never can." A fierce partisan, Jackson is among the most colorful and controversial of American presidents, both admired and criticized by historians. His reputation suffered as historians came to see his military campaigns against indigenous nations as genocide. His unrepentant ownership of slaves also complicates his legacy. In his lifetime and for many generations thereafter, Jackson was one of the most admired figures in American history. When the United States won independence, the southeastern Chickasaw, Choctaw, Muscogee Creek, Seminole, and Cherokee nations were well established and autonomous. Thomas Jefferson believed that the tribal nations of North America were the intellectual equals of European Americans, and his government tried to peacefully absorb the nations so long as they adopted American values and assimilated into a new hybrid culture. Jackson fought with and against many of the nations in the years before he became president. Indigenous warriors were at his side at the Battle of New Orleans. However, his attitude toward the nations could be brutal. In 1818, he took it upon his own authority to invade Florida and provoke the Seminole Wars. Jackson came to believe there was no place for the southeastern nations east of the Mississippi and moved to transfer land west of the Mississippi to them. He thus put into motion the notorious Indian Removal Act of 1830 and forcibly removed the nations from their ancestral homes in the southeastern United States along the Trail of Tears. A more perfect union. Before his death, Jackson supported the annexation of Texas following the 1836 Anglo-Texan Revolution against President General Antonio Lopez de Santa Anna, the Napoleon of the West, who had usurped the Mexican Constitution of 1824. Jackson's successor, Martin Van Buren, believed the annexation of Texas was a liability that would arouse anti-slave opposition and trigger a war with Mexico. On March 6, 1836, after a costly 13-day siege, an infuriated Santa Anna infamously put to the sword all the Texan defenders of the Alamo Presidio in San Antonio, commanded by Colonel William Barrett Travis. The garrison included American legends Davy Crockett and Jim Bowie. Like Jackson at New Orleans, Travis fought from behind fixed emplacements. Santa Anna was unaware of British military doctrine, since New Orleans, that massed infantry could not directly assault American riflemen behind breastworks without an unacceptable cost. The marksmen from Tennessee and Kentucky did not miss. Sharpshooters killed hundreds of smartly attired and disciplined Mexican troops before they overwhelmed the doomed garrison. Travis bought the Texans precious time. On April 21, 1836, in a battle that lasted only 18 minutes, General Sam Houston and the Texan Army engaged and defeated leading elements of the Mexican Army at San Jacinto. The next day, Houston captured a humiliated Santa Anna, disguised as a soldier, and forced Caudillo Máximo to sign a treaty that withdrew sizable remaining Mexican forces from Texas, which declared itself to be an independent country. Northwest Territory icon General William Henry Harrison defeated Van Buren in the 1840 election, but fell ill and died after only 1 month in office. John Tyler of Virginia succeeded the hero of Tippecanoe, who defeated the eloquent Shawnee leader Tecumseh's formidable tribal confederation. Tyler, an expansionist, conducted sensitive negotiations with Houston to bring Texas into the Union. The controversial Tyler also switched parties from Whig to Democratic-Republican. On December 29, 1845, Tyler's successor, James K. Polk, signed legislation making the former Lone Star Republic the 28th state of the Union. Secretary of State Daniel Webster of Massachusetts resigned. Henry Clay, the great compromiser, also opposed Texas annexation. Clay, Webster, and John C. Calhoun were the great triumvirate that put together the Missouri Compromise of 1820, the Compromise Tariff of 1833, and the Compromise of 1850. Clay was known as the champion of Western interests, Webster, Northern free interests, and Calhoun, Southern slave interests. During 1846, Polk negotiated the Oregon Treaty with Great Britain. As early as 1818, the United States and Britain agreed to fix the border between the United States and Canada along the 49th parallel from Minnesota Territory west to the Rocky Mountains. While the United States proposed to extend the border to the Pacific Ocean, Britain wanted it drawn west to the Columbia River and from there to the western coast. Inexorable American immigration along the Oregon Trail into the territory created an emotional issue in Congress and the slogan, 5440 or fight, indicating the line of latitude preferred for the border. The parties settled the competing claims of Russia and Spain and peacefully agreed to a compromise settling on the 49th parallel border, but giving all of Vancouver Island to Canada. Following the annexation of Texas, relations between the United States and Mexico deteriorated because the border with Mexico had never been formally fixed. The border, according to Texas, was the Rio Grande. Mexico considered the Rio Nueces to be the border. Polk ordered General Zachary Taylor to garrison the southern border of Texas along the Rio Grande, which Mexico regarded as a violation of its sovereignty. Mexican forces attacked an American outpost in the disputed territory, and war broke out. The Americans quickly occupied Santa Fe de Nuevo Mexico along the upper Rio Grande and the province of Alto California. On March 9, 1847, American forces made an amphibious landing from the Gulf of Mexico at Veracruz. The ensuing campaign resembled the advance of Hernan Cortes and his conquistadors from Veracruz to the Aztec capital of Tenochtitlan in 1591 and 1592. U.S. forces, commanded by General Winfield Scott, entered Mexico City on September 14, 1847, and raised the stars and stripes over the halls of Montezuma. On February 2, 1848, the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo ended the war. Mexico ceded Alto California and Santa Fe, Nuevo Mexico, to the United States in exchange for a $15 million lump sum payment and the assumption by the United States of $3.25 million in Mexican debt owed to American citizens. Mexico acknowledged the loss of Texas and accepted the Rio Grande border. There was nothing dishonorable about the war and outcome from the American point of view. Mexico all but assured war by declaring American annexation of Texas to be unacceptable. For Mexico, losing half of its original territory was a humiliating disaster that Mexican patriots would never forgive or forget. The vigorous and confident United States won continental expansion, but at a steep price in casualties, money, and virtue. Strongly resisted by anti-expansion northern abolitionists, the war accelerated the bitter debates that led to the American Civil War. Tensions between the United States and Mexico complicated efforts to survey a practical southern route for a transcontinental railroad. James Gadsden, the American ambassador to Mexico, negotiated a treaty to pay Mexico $10 million for 29,670 square miles of territory that later became part of Arizona and New Mexico. The Senate ratified the Gadsden Purchase on April 25, 1854. President Polk was a firm believer in the concept of manifest destiny, as foreseen by Alexander Hamilton. There were three tenets to this vision: the special virtues of the American people and their institutions, the mission of the United States to redeem and remake the West in the Jeffersonian image of agrarian America, and a divine destiny to carry out this essential duty. The theme of virtue became identified as American exceptionalism. Puritan founder John Winthrop's famous 1630 City Upon a Hill sermon suggested this when he called for a virtuous community that would be a shining example to the old world. In his provocative 1776 pamphlet, Common Sense, Thomas Paine argued that we have it in our power to begin the world over again. A situation similar to the present hath not happened since the days of Noah until now. The birthday of a new world is at hand. Thus, the westward expansion of the United States continued beyond North America. A lucrative China trade meant that fast Yankee clipper ships needed a network of ports across the Pacific Ocean. When Commodore Matthew Perry sailed to Japan in 1853, his primary motivation was to strengthen America's trading position and diplomacy with China. As the United States opened consulates across the Pacific, American planters and whaling interests settled in Hawaii, leading to the annexation of the islands in 1898. Democrats tended to favor territorial expansion, while the Whigs saw America's moral mission as only one of democratic example. By 1843, former President John Quincy Adams and other prominent leaders had repudiated continental consolidation because the annexation of Texas meant the expansion of slavery. In fact, although he preferred peaceful coexistence within a greater Mexico, Stephen Fuller Austin, the founder of the Republic of Texas in 1825, split with emancipated Mexico over slavery. According to historian Frederick Merck, Manifest Destiny lacked national, sectional, or party following commensurate with its magnitude. Influential journalist John L. O'Sullivan was an advocate of Jacksonian democracy. In an 1839 essay, he predicted a divine destiny for the United States that was not explicitly territorial. In 1845, O'Sullivan wrote another essay where he first used the phrase Manifest Destiny to urge the annexation of Texas. He again invoked the specific phrase in a December 27, 1845, article in the New York Morning News, asserting that the United States had the right to claim the whole of Oregon by the right of our manifest destiny to possess the whole of the continent which Providence has given us for the development of the great experiment of liberty and federated self-government entrusted to us. On January 3, 1846, Representative Robert Winthrop of Massachusetts rose to ridicule the concept on the House floor, saying, "I suppose the right of a manifest destiny to spread will not be admitted to exist in any nation except the universal Yankee nation." Winthrop was among many critics who suggested that advocates were citing divine providence to justify actions motivated, from their perspective, by chauvinism and self-interest. Among the most profound and lasting results of expansionism was the European settlement and development of rich Midwestern farmlands. New immigrants from Germany, Scandinavia, and Eastern Europe joined pioneers from Eastern families as farms and communities sprouted up west of the Mississippi River and into the Dakotas. The Homestead Act of 1862 encouraged 600,000 families to settle the West by giving them land almost for free, which they had to live on for 5 years. The homesteaders faced great physical problems, including attacks by hostile indigenous tribes, plagues of insects, and harsh winter weather. Rapid changes in railroad transportation and other tools rewarded those who persevered, easing some of the hardships. Eventually, the government gave away more than 270 million acres of public land, 10% of the United States, to 1.6 million homesteaders. It was inevitable and tragic that the relentless westward push of American European civilization would displace and harm the native peoples. During the early generations of contact with Europeans, disease had wiped out entire indigenous populations who had no immunity to common European infirmities. Expansionism marginalized the surviving indigenous people. At every step, agrarian Eastern nations and nomadic Western nations were deceived, cheated, resettled, and murdered. Americans of moral disposition were ashamed and repentant, but powerless to stop the inevitable. The media fueled the march west by misrepresenting facts, creating legends, exhorting settlement, justifying extermination, and abetting the eventual captivity of the remaining indigenous nations. Until a reckoning between North and South occurred, Manifest Destiny offered nothing to enslaved Africans. During the antebellum era, Southern planters continued to grow tobacco and rice as they had in colonial days. The creation of a mechanical cotton gin by Eli Whitney in 1793 revolutionized the production of cotton, which was, heretofore, not grown as a commodity crop in the United States. By the 1850s, the hot and humid American Deep South supplied 80% of the world's cotton, with most of the slaves in America producing 2 billion pounds of cotton per year. The hybrid Gossypium barbadense, or petit gulf cotton, is an easily grown, stored, and transported staple crop that defined the conviction of Southern politicians and planters. Slaves cleared forests and cultivated the lucrative crop for white planters from Georgia to Texas. This was a far different America than Jefferson's vision of white yeoman farmers that was simultaneously taking root in the North and West. For decades, white American politicians and scholars, including Jefferson, agonized over the cultural ramifications of abolishing slavery. The black slave population of the United States surged from 400,000 in 1808, when Congress banned the importation of slaves, to about 4 million by 1861. Southern authorities were terrified. Among the most militant were the state legislatures in South Carolina and Mississippi, where most of the population was black. In 1858, South Carolina Senator and former governor James Henry Hammond confidently proclaimed on the Senate floor that the North could never threaten the South because cotton is king. But cotton with slavery was a one-dimensional economic trap. As the Industrial Revolution advanced in the North, the South became dependent for food, resources, and financing. Its rail transportation infrastructure was inadequate, and the North could blockade its ports in the event of war. The proud and prejudiced South was vulnerable. Southern representatives tried to expand slavery to new states and territories, leading to a series of compromises with the polarized North. The discovery of gold by James W. Marshall at Sutter's Mill near Coloma in 1848 lured about 300,000 prospectors to California and intensified the issue, as all the Western territories were potentially new free states. The pivotal and potentially powerful California joined the Union on September 9, 1850, as a free state in the Compromise of 1850, consisting of five laws that resolved the status of the territories won from Mexico. Henry Clay's bargain, supported by Daniel Webster and opposed by John C. Calhoun, confirmed Texas as a slave state, but ensured that slavery did not spread west to the Pacific. In his influential treatise, Democracy in America, Alexis de Tocqueville observed that the colonies in which there were no slaves became more populous and richer than those in which slavery flourished. By 1860, the southern states had a population of 12 million, including 4 million slaves. The northern states had a population of 19 million and virtually no slaves. In a series of 3/5 legislative acts that enshrined disproportionate southern political power in the Constitution, slaves counted in the calculation of how many representatives a state held in Congress, 3/5 of a free person. In the 1857 Dred Scott case, the Supreme Court held that a slave did not become free when transported to a free state, but that the slave remained the property of his or her owner. People of African descent imported into the United States as slaves and their descendants could never be citizens. As Western territories populated by immigrant homesteaders lined up to become new free states, tensions gave way to violence in Bloody Kansas, only admitted in 1861 and following the election of 1860. Abolitionist activist John Brown tried to incite an armed slave revolt by seizing the U.S. arsenal at Harper's Ferry, Virginia, on October 16, 1859. Brown had invited fellow activists Harriet Tubman and Frederick Douglass to join him, but Tubman was ill, and Douglass wisely declined. When Brown occupied Harper's Ferry, an alert sounded. Under the command of Colonel Robert E. Lee of the Army's 2nd Cavalry Regiment, Lieutenant J.E.B. Stuart and a company of U.S. Marines attacked and subdued Brown's group when they refused to surrender. The United States tried Brown for treason and executed him by hanging on December 2nd. The question of slavery passed the point of no return with the election of Westerner and Republican Abraham Lincoln of Illinois on November 6, 1860. Lincoln defeated a Democratic Party divided between Northern candidate Stephen A. Douglas and Southern candidate John C. Breckinridge. There was also a fourth candidate, John Bell of the Constitutional Union Party. Lincoln had not even appeared on the ballots in 10 Southern slave states. Lincoln won the Electoral College 180-123, but only carried 39% of the popular vote. In the months leading to the inauguration, 7 Southern states seceded from the Union to form the Confederate States of America. 4 more Southern states seceded after Lincoln's inauguration. Cataclysm came on April 12, 1861, when Confederate artillery opened fire on the federal garrison at Fort Sumter, South Carolina. Although later generations rationalized the war as a noble battle to protect states' rights and the Southern way of life, in 1861, slavery was the Southern way of life. Confederate leaders explicitly announced that the protection of slavery and the cotton economy was their reason to secede and wage war. Although most Confederate soldiers were people of modest means who did not own slaves, still, almost one-third of all white Southern families owned slaves. Slave labor and fertile soil enabled Deep South capitalism. In 1857, Mexico fell into one of its own series of civil wars, pitting the forces of liberal reformist Benito Juarez, who admired Abraham Lincoln, against conservatives led by Felix Zuloaga. The United States recognized the Juarez government in 1859. In 1862, Emperor Napoleon II maneuvered to set up a French-sponsored monarchy in Mexico, installing Maximilian of Habsburg, the Archduke of Austria, as Emperor of Mexico. Napoleon's reasoning was that the United States, embroiled in its civil war, could not stop this violation of the Monroe Doctrine. Secretary of State William Henry Seward had no desire to challenge France and open the door to French aid to the Confederacy. During the French invasion, Juarez led a popular national insurgency. After the end of the American Civil War, Seward was free to give support to Juarez. Napoleon withdrew French troops, and the insurgents captured and executed the ill-fated Maximilian. In a fatal miscalculation, the Confederates banned cotton exports to force British diplomatic recognition. Britain and Europe simply developed other sources for cotton, Egypt and India. By the time the Confederates realized their error, a federal blockade forced the Confederacy to rely on smugglers. Cotton exports to Europe dropped to almost none in 1862, and the Southern economy collapsed. Following the bloodiest day in American history at the Battle of Antietam, Lincoln signed an executive order on September 22, 1862, and then an Emancipation Proclamation on January 1, 1863. Bypassing Congress, he changed the status of persons held as slaves in the Confederate-controlled territories from slave to free. On April 8, 1864, the Senate passed the 13th Amendment to the Constitution, abolishing slavery except as punishment for a crime. The House passed the amendment on January 31, 1865. The Supreme Court found secession to be unconstitutional in Texas v. White. On November 19, 1863, Lincoln brilliantly summed up his war aims and vision for a more perfect union and national reconciliation in an address dedicating the Soldiers' Cemetery at Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, the site of the war's pivotal battle. Lincoln's succinct remarks followed a 2-hour oration by former Senator and Secretary of State Edward Everett. While the viewpoint of the enemy Confederate media was naturally negative toward the despised Lincoln, it is illustrative to remember how divided and often defeatist the Northern media were during the war. The Northern media callously smeared Abraham Lincoln. In 1864, the Northern Democrats ran General George McClellan for president against Lincoln on an appeasement platform, promising to end the war with an armistice in which the Southern states would keep slavery. The fortunes of war changed when Lincoln allowed General Ulysses Grant and his lieutenants from the Union's Western armies of the Cumberland and Tennessee, including General William Tecumseh Sherman, to wage total war and implement a scorched earth policy. Grant knew from bitter experience at Shiloh and Vicksburg that the enemy could not survive a brutal war of attrition. He was not hesitant, as had been Lincoln's inept Army of the Potomac commanders, including the ambitious Democrat McClellan. It was only a matter of time before the chivalrous General Robert E. Lee, commander of the Army of Northern Virginia, and his gallant field commanders ran out of food, clothing, and ammunition. The mythical, serene, and civilized plantation Dixie of Margaret Mitchell's Gone with the Wind disappeared at Appomattox Courthouse on the afternoon of April 9, 1865. Deranged Southern sympathizer and actor John Wilkes Booth assassinated Lincoln on April 14 at Ford's Theater in Washington, D.C. The critical media deified the slain president as a martyr and the beloved savior of the Union, which in fact he was. Some 620,000 Americans lost their lives. The 1861 to 1865 war remains America's most costly conflict, rivaled only by World War II. Taken as a percentage of America's 21st century population, the shocking toll is equivalent to 6 million lives. These Americans paid reparations for America's original sin of slavery on the bloody battlefields of Shiloh, Antietam, and Gettysburg. The excesses of Reconstruction destroyed Lincoln's vision for a peaceful reconciliation between the states. Bureaucratic incompetence and opportunistic carpetbaggers embittered white Southerners and abandoned the freed blacks. Many disgruntled whites joined violent, racist, anti-Catholic, and anti-Jewish vigilante groups, such as the Ku Klux Klan. Legislated and legalized racial discrimination, institutionalized segregation, and Jim Crow laws that denied voting rights to newly emancipated African-American citizens would follow well into the next century. The South would remain disadvantaged until World War II. Rationalizing defeat, generations of Confederate descendants perpetuated the myth of the Confederacy as the noble cause. The American Civil War and emancipation transformed the historic dependence of global trade on slave labor and thus the world economic order. From this point forward, politicians, planters, manufacturers, and merchants had to reform capitalism with free and fair labor or face the consequences of new movements such as socialism. Popular pre-war stage productions, known as minstrel shows, grew in popularity during Reconstruction and well into the next century with vaudeville. The popular and pleasant songs of the prolific Stephen Collins Foster immortalized a mythical genteel South and were respectful of traditional African-American spiritual musical tradition. The darker side of the popular traveling productions was the negative portrayal of African-American citizens as comic inferiors and the use of blackface makeup by white performers to imitate blacks. The effect of the shows was to perpetuate stereotypes, institutional racism, and discrimination. Westward the course of empire. In 1725, Tsar Peter the Great sent Vitus Bering and Alexei Chirikov to explore Alaska and the Pacific coast. In 1856, when Russia lost the Crimean War, the imperial government in St. Petersburg lacked the financial resources and will to continue supporting a toehold along the Pacific coast of North America. Russia offered to sell Alaska to the United States in 1859. The American Civil War delayed the transaction, but following the war, Seward resumed negotiations. On March 30, 1867, the United States agreed to buy Alaska for $7.2 million, and it became American territory on October 18. Media and political skeptics sarcastically called the purchase of Alaska Seward's folly. However, the discovery of gold in the Yukon in 1896, making Alaska the gateway to the Klondike, vindicated Seward. On May 10, 1869, Amasa Leland Stanford, the president of the Central Pacific Railroad Company of California, drove a ceremonial last spike into the tracks at Promontory Summit, Utah Territory, marking the completion of a transcontinental railroad. The Union Pacific Railroad's free Irish immigrant laborers and others had built west from Omaha, Nebraska, and the Central Pacific's free Chinese immigrant laborers and others had built east from Sacramento, California. The dream of Hamilton and a presidential priority of Abraham Lincoln to span the continent had become a reality. The men who financed, designed, and built lines east and west had created an engineering marvel, and there was nothing like it in the world. America was, finally, a truly transcontinental nation from sea to shining sea. Lincoln's foresight and faith in the exceptional General Grenville Dodge of Council Bluffs, Iowa, chief engineer of the Union Pacific, was well placed. Dodge succeeded despite a multitude of competing business interests, intrigues, and setbacks. In 1859, when Lincoln was an Illinois politician and railroad attorney, he met Dodge in Iowa. Lincoln's first words were, "Dodge, what is the best route for a Pacific Railroad to the West?" Dodge convinced Lincoln to follow a Platte River Valley route and found a way through the Black Hills, Wyoming, and Utah. The president was the most ardent supporter of the Transcontinental Railroad, which he saw a strategic necessity, and Dodge was his man. The establishment of the Transcontinental Railroad and new settlements attracted thousands of Americans of European descent to the frontier. Improved communications and reduced travel times hinted at a prosperous future for the farmers and ranchers who were rapidly populating the West. The days when mountain men and fur trappers risked their lives to explore, trap, and trade were over. The nation celebrated its centennial, but had suffered an economic depression in 1873. President Ulysses Grant needed an economic stimulus package. The discovery of gold in the Black Hills in South Dakota, lands that were sacred to the Lakota people, was helpful. The United States ordered the Lakota Nation to surrender the Black Hills so that prospectors could exploit the mineral wealth of the region. The tribal leaders refused, and the army moved to enforce the eviction. The resulting annihilation of Lieutenant Colonel George Armstrong Custer and much of his command at Little Bighorn, Montana Territory, on June 25, 1876, shocked Americans. After the disaster, the national media glorified the impetuous and incompetent Custer. The 36-year-old boy general of Civil War fame divided his 7th Cavalry Regiment command of 647 men into three columns. Against orders, he led 268 troopers and Crow and Pawnee scouts to their deaths by attacking at least 2,000 armed and motivated Lakota Sioux and Northern Cheyenne warriors. Led by Hunk Papa leader Sitting Bull, Khatanka Iotaki, who outnumbered the five companies of cavalrymen 9-1. The Little Bighorn was one of a series of climatic battles fought in the Dakota, Montana, and Wyoming territories, known variously as the Great Sioux War of 1876 and the Black Hills War. Other engagements included the battles of Powder River, Warbonnet Creek, Rosebud, Slim Buttes, Cedar Creek, and Wolf Mountain. Little Bighorn was the greatest Allied tribal triumph since the arrival of Europeans to North America. It was a Pyrrhic victory that was avoidable from the American military perspective and that came too late to stop the inevitable. Wounded Knee and the twilight of the indigenous cultures were at hand. Reviewing the results of the 1890 United States Census, historian Frederick Jackson Turner announced in 1893 that rapid Western settlement meant there can hardly be said to be a frontier line. In the quarter century since the end of the Civil War, new European immigrants made the West America's most culturally diverse region. Although most Western residents lived in new cities and towns, over 3 million agrarian families were working the land. The 1890 census also showed that the indigenous population of the United States was 248,253, down from the 400,764 people found in the 1850 census. During the first half of the 19th century, German and Irish immigrants swarmed into America. Toward the close of the century, the nation experienced a new wave of immigration from Italy. The Catholic population of the United States was increasing exponentially. America was also about to absorb a new wave of immigrants from Eastern Europe, including more Catholics from Poland and Austro-Hungarian nations. A sizable number of Jewish immigrants from Eastern Europe and Imperial Russia joined the steady flow of people entering the United States. The new European citizens would soon produce a generation of leaders who would affect the prosperity, progress, and perspective of the United States. In June 1894, the American Railway Union struck the Pullman Palace Car Company, and railway workers nationwide refused to handle Pullman cars. Some 125,000 railroad workers shut down 29 railroads and paralyzed the nation. Riots and sabotage followed. A federal court invoked the Sherman Antitrust Act of 1890, but workers ignored the order. Democratic President Grover Cleveland ordered the U.S. Army and federal marshals to end the strike, citing disruption to the U.S. mail. Southern and Western Democrats and populists denounced Cleveland's intervention. The most serious incidents of the strike occurred in and around Chicago, headquarters of the Pullman Company and the nation's central railway hub. The American Federation of Labor did not support the strike. President Cleveland's intervention infuriated Illinois Governor John P. Altgeld. Media coverage was mostly negative toward the strikers. Editors denounced immigrant workers, anarchy, and defiance of the law. The government arrested Eugene V. Debs, president of the American Railway Union, and sentenced him to 6 months in prison. Debs became an advocate of socialism and ran for president 5 times as head of the Socialist Party of America. In a gesture of conciliation hailed by Samuel Gompers, president of the American Federation of Labor, Cleveland and Congress made Labor Day a federal holiday. The economic turmoil also encouraged the formation of the People's Party, or Populists. This leftist movement was critical of the banking system and railroads and drew support from angry Southern and Western farmers. The party existed from 1891 until 1919, although its largest influence was between 1892 and 1896. The People's Party carried 4 states in the 1892 presidential election won by Cleveland. In 1896, the Democrats nominated gifted orator William Jennings Bryan for president. Bryan favored much of the populist agenda and generated great excitement with his Cross of Gold speech. Bryan had an opportunity to win the election if the populists threw their support behind him, which, after serious debate among themselves, they did. But in the end, Bryan lost to Republican William McKinley, who defeated him again in a 1900 rematch. In 1890, an American naval officer, Captain Alfred Thayer Mahon, wrote The Influence of Sea Power Upon History, 1660 to 1783. It was his strong belief that the United States and Great Britain had common security interests. In an 1890 article that appeared in Atlantic Monthly, Mahon proposed that the United States should come to a cordial understanding with Britain because we share a similarity of character and ideas that would ultimately yield cooperation beneficial to both. Mahon went further in an 1894 North American Review article, The Possibilities of an Anglo-American Reunion, in which he states, "To Great Britain and the United States is entrusted a maritime interest in the broadest sense of the word, which demands, as one of the conditions of its exercise and its safety, the organized force adequate to control the general course of events at sea." Mahon advocated the annexation of Hawaii and the Philippine Islands. He felt that the world was shrinking and that an isolated America was vulnerable, explaining, "Though distant, our shores can be reached." He also recommended the construction of a canal across Central America to assert American control of the Caribbean Sea and to enable the rapid movement of ships between the Atlantic and Pacific. It was therefore inevitable that Mahan came to the attention of the Assistant Secretary of the Navy and the future President, Theodore Roosevelt. The men corresponded regularly, and Mahan had a considerable influence on Roosevelt's thinking. The first transcontinental single-wire telegraph began service on October 24, 1861, and offered near-instantaneous communication using the Morse code between the east and west coasts of the United States. By comparison, messages carried by daring Pony Express riders took many days. The invention of American artist Samuel Morse was a quantum leap in linking a continental nation, despite interruptions caused by harsh weather, irritated indigenous peoples, and the Civil War. The Commercial Cable Company of New York became one of the world's leading technology companies, controlling 5 of the 16 undersea cables that sent telegrams across the Atlantic Ocean. The company also ran one of 2 new cables across the Pacific Ocean. The undersea cables meant that messages could be sent to and from the United States in minutes rather than weeks or months. The capitalist and liberal democratic America enabled inventors and entrepreneurs who changed the course of human history. Small groups of pioneers developed audio and visual technology invented and inspired by the prolific inventor and businessman Thomas Alva Edison of Menlo Park, New Jersey, including audio recording and the phonograph, the motion picture camera, the light bulb, and batteries. In addition to making the modern industrialized world possible, Edison made modern mass communication possible. Meanwhile, Orville and Wilbur Wright of Dayton, Ohio, would take to powered flight on December 17, 1903, on the Outer Banks of North Carolina at Killdevil Hills. Henry Ford of Dearborn, Michigan, was perfecting the manufacture of powered horseless carriages, which would become known as automobiles. Cities and towns were becoming lit by electricity, and speaking "ahoy, ahoy" into his invention, Canadian-born Alexander Graham Bell revolutionized communications with the telephone. As of 1898, Spain continued to keep its colonies of Cuba, Puerto Rico, Guam, and the Philippine Islands. Revolts were long simmering in Cuba, leading America.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.